A very good evening to all. Welcome back to CMC Medicine lecture series. Today's lecture series will be starting with endocrinology. This is the first set of lectures that's been conducted by endocrinology for the Department of Medicine, especially for the PG students in the Department of Medicine. This lecture series is for the next 6 weeks on every Fridays from 4:30 to 5:30 p.m. for endocrinology. Today's lecture is on Cushing's syndrome by Dr. Asha. Ma'am is a professor in the Department of Endocrinology, Christian Medical College. Her field of interest is in pituitary and adrenal disorders and young diabetes. Ma'am per se is a very knowledgeable and more than that, very approachable teacher to all of us and very dear teacher to all of us. Hope you guys will have a very valuable session during the next 1 hour. And I hope, and if anyone have any doubts, please put in your doubts in the chat box or can ask directly to ma'am at the end of the lecture. This lecture will be uploaded on our YouTube website later on in the Department of Medicine YouTube website. Now, over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I would like to thank the Department of Medicine for giving us this opportunity to take these sessions, and thereby we can learn from each other. So this session will be on approach to Cushing syndrome. Basically, I'll be covering the diagnosis and management of Cushing syndrome. So Cushing syndrome consists of a group of symptoms and signs resulting from exposure to prolonged excessive amounts of glucocorticoids. The incidence of endogenous Cushing syndrome is about 2 to 3 per million, and there is a female preponderance of this condition. So it was first described by Harvey Cushing's in 1912, who initially described the syndrome in a 23-year-old lady who presented with obesity, hirsutism, and amenorrhea. This was later attributed to a pituitary abnormality resulting in adrenal hyperplasia. The ectopic acetate syndrome was described much later, after 1928. So the spectrum of cortisol overproduction may vary from just mild symptoms of cortisol excess to marked cortisol excess. Like you can see in these pictures, there are 3 patients all having Cushing syndrome, but with varying degrees of severity. The mildest on the left corner and the most severe in the right corner. So sometimes mild Cushing's may be missed and may just be thought as obesity or hypothyroidism. Hence, some of the aspects of evaluation of Cushing's may be useful in deciphering the diagnosis in some of these patients. The commonest etiology of Cushing syndrome is exogenous glucocorticoid excess, where over-the-counter glucocorticoids are used for management of asthma, arthritis, vague aches and pains, etc. Endogenous Cushing syndrome is further classified as ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome and ACTH-independent Cushing's. Now, coming to the causes of Cushing syndrome, ACTH-dependent Cushing's is the most common, constituting about 80% of all Cushing syndrome, of which pituitary dependent Cushing's is the most common in this group, again constituting 68% of all Cushing's. The ectopic ACTH syndrome is due to ectopic secretion of ACTH from various carcinoid tumors arising from the bronchus, thymus, pancreatic carcinoids, as well as small cell carcinoma of the lung, and this constitutes about 12%. Ectopic CRH production from certain tumors like pheochromocytoma is very rare. Among the causes of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome, this constitutes about 20% of all cases of Cushing's. Under this, adrenal adenoma is the most common, followed by adrenocortical carcinoma. Macronodular and micronodular adrenal hyperplasia are less common. Sometimes there can be aberrant expression of various other receptors on the adrenals, and that can give rise to aberrant receptor-mediated Cushing's due to macronodular adrenal hyperplasia like GIP, which leads to food-dependent Cushing's. Then beta-adrenergic agonist, interleukin, LH. LH causes pregnancy-dependent Cushing's, etc. There is another entity called pseudo-Cushing syndrome. Pseudo Cushing's resembles Cushing's in some of the clinical features of Cushing syndrome. Also, they can have mildly elevated serum and urinary cortisol levels, and it may also be partially unsuppressible with dexamethasone. So this condition is seen with depression, alcohol dependence, morbid obesity, poorly controlled diabetes. In these conditions, when the underlying cause is treated, the symptoms and signs of Cushing syndrome as well as the cortisol excess reverts back to normal. And hence, it is called pseudo-Cushing's. It is not actually a state of cortisol excess, but it is a condition which leads to activation of the hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis. Coming to the various symptoms and signs of Cushing syndrome, like menstrual irregularity, plethora, depression, hirsutism, muscle weakness, recurrent infections, many of these symptoms as well as signs of Cushing syndrome can be seen in obesity as well. So there are different series which have compared patients with Cushing syndrome and compared them with obese controls, and they have derived what is known as a discriminant index. So this discriminant index is the ratio of the prevalence of a particular symptom or sign or a condition in patients with Cushing syndrome versus those with obesity. So what you can see here is that patients with Cushing syndrome have muscle weakness and facial plethora as very significant features, which are much, much more common in Cushing's as compared to obesity. And similarly, osteopenia, recurrent infections, presence of striae, amenorrhea, central obesity are also more common in Cushing's and helps to distinguish Cushing's from obesity. So the higher the discriminant index, the greater the propensity, greater the chance of a person to have Cushing's as compared to exogenous obesity. The clinical features, as I mentioned, the discriminatory features are facial plethora, myopathy, cutaneous striae, which are more than 1 centimeter wide, presence of thin skin leading to bruising. And in children, they may not have the classical features of Cushing syndrome, but they can just present with weight gain and reduced height percentile compared to their peers. In addition to this, diabetes, hypertension, and osteoporosis are also more common with Cushing's. The less discriminatory features would include central obesity, presence of a dorsocervical pad of fat, supraclavicular fullness, poor wound healing, peripheral edema, weight gain, depression, mood changes, oligomenorrhea, recurrent infections, and because of hypercalciuria, they're also a little more prone to develop kidney stones. Coming to ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome, some features help us differentiate pituitary ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome, which is also known as Cushing's disease, from the ectopic ACTH syndrome. The pituitary ACTH-producing tumors slowly grows over a period of time, leading to a slowly increasing ACTH excess, leading to a correspondingly increasing cortisol. So the course is very gradual. Most often these patients have symptoms for at least 3 to 5 years before they are diagnosed with Cushing syndrome. And they have the classical features of cortisol excess like easy bruising, skin thinning, and purple striae. Whereas when a patient comes with the sudden onset of the Cushingoid features over a period of just a few months, and sometimes maybe up to 1-1.5 years, with a short history, lack of the classical clinical signs, they may even present with weight loss, but they have the classical hyperpigmentation, severe myopathy, and severe hypokalemia. Those are the features of ectopic ACTH syndrome. Ectopic ACTH syndrome is also more common in men and in the older age group, while Cushing's disease, that is ACTH producing pituitary adenoma, is more common in young or middle-aged females. Sometimes the diagnosis of Cushing's may be missed in patients with rheumatological disorders who are intermittently treated with steroids, patients with psychiatric problems who often have obesity as an associated feature, but Cushing's can also present with psychiatric problems. So hence, we need to keep our mind open when we are seeing these kind of patients where they might have received some exogenous steroids at some point in time, but could still have endogenous hypercortisolism. Similarly, as I mentioned earlier, children may have lack the classical clinical features of protein catabolism and hence may just present with growth retardation and obesity and should be evaluated. So whom do we screen for Cushing syndrome? When you have a patient coming with unusual features for age, suppose you have a young or a middle-aged person coming with osteoporosis and hypertension, then you would think of Cushing syndrome. Again, patients who present with multiple or progressive clinical features evolving over a period of time, children with decreasing height percentile and increasing weight, and patients with adrenal incidentaloma who come for evaluation should be tested for cortisol excess. Whenever you are planning to test for cortisol excess, always take a detailed history about oral or injectable steroids. Quite often we have seen in our OPDs that a patient denies a history of steroid intake, but when you ask them, they say that quite often they go to the local hospital and get some injections for body pains, etc. Metroxyprogesterone acetate is a progestogen which can again mimic some symptoms of cortisol excess because it can also cause fluid retention and some Cushingoid features. Also, don't forget to ask about history of indigenous medications, tonics, powders, etc., which may contain steroids. And it is very important to exclude these exogenous glucocorticoid excess before you embark on a detailed evaluation for endogenous Cushing syndrome. Coming to the biochemical investigations, the most important investigation in these patients is first to check a morning serum cortisol. This helps to distinguish exogenous cortisol excess from endogenous cortisol excess. So when you have a person who has been taking an exogenous glucocorticoid, unless it is hydrocortisone, all the others will suppress the HPA axis and the morning cortisol will be low. Suppose your patient has taken hydrocortisone tablet and then gives a sample, then the cortisol level will be high. So it's also important to check all the tablets and medications that the patient is on before doing the test. And next, proceed with the screening tests followed by the confirmatory tests and finally the differential diagnosis. So among the screening tests, we have three screening tests that are available. That is the urine-free cortisol, late night serum or salivary cortisol, and the overnight dexamethasone suppression test. So the urine-free cortisol, the cortisol that is produced in the body over a period of 24 hours gets filtered in the urine. And so this provides an integrated assessment of cortisol secretion over a 24-hour period. So this cortisol, which we are detecting in the urine, is free cortisol. It is not bound to cortisol binding globulin, and hence it is not affected by conditions that alter the cortisol binding globulin, like OCPs, severe illness and nephrotic syndrome, where the cortisol binding globulin can be low. OCPs and pregnancies are other conditions where the cortisol binding globulin can be elevated, and that can lead to falsely high serum cortisol while the urinary cortisol is not affected. So the cutoff which is recommended is more than the upper limit of normal. So for our assay in the lab is 100 micrograms per day. But when you have a cortisol value between 100 to 300, that is when it is less than three times the upper limit of normal, you interpret it with caution because conditions like obesity may be associated with mild elevated urinary cortisol levels. And the measurement by assays which use the LC-MS, that is the mass spectrometry, will have lower values because they are not affected by other cortisol intermediates or metabolites. So the values which you obtain from an LC-MS assay will be about 40% of that which you measure by the common immunoassays, what we measure routinely in our lab. Also, there is a day-to-day variability in the amount of cortisol that is excreted in urine, and hence it's important to collect at least two samples. So the sensitivity of the urinary cortisol is about 90%, and the specificity of the measurement is only 70%, because as I mentioned, obesity, depression, all these conditions, and any illness per se can give rise to falsely elevated urinary cortisol. Also, if a person is drinking more than 5 liters of fluid per day, it can cause a falsely high urinary cortisol. Patients with renal impairment can have falsely low UFC. And also, patients with cyclical Cushing's, where there is intermittent cortisol excess, they can have falsely low values during the remission phase. Again, as I said, UFC can be elevated in obesity, in those with psychiatric disorders, alcohol dependence, anorexia nervosa, etc. Some drugs can also interfere with the UFC, but that's very rare. Now coming to the late night serum cortisol. So in healthy individuals who are remaining in the same time zone for the last 2 to 3 weeks and who have a stable sleep-wake cycle, the cortisol level begins to rise by 3 to 4 a.m. in the morning, reaches peak by 7 to 9 o'clock and then falls for the rest of the day, and very low levels are seen at midnight. So this is the normal circadian rhythm of cortisol. So loss of this circadian rhythm with absence of late night cortisol nadir is a consistent finding in all conditions of endogenous cortisol excess. So how do we do this test? An IV cannula is inserted 6 hours before the test and blood sample is collected at 12 midnight from the cannula. So if a person is awake at the time of testing, you take a cutoff of 7.5 micrograms per deciliter and any value above that indicates Cushing's syndrome. If the person is asleep and you have taken the sample within 5 to 10 minutes of waking up, then a value more than 1.8 should be considered as the cutoff. The sensitivity is about 96 to 100% and specificity 83 to 96%. Now we have another tool that is available, that is the late night salivary cortisol. So this test is done by collecting the saliva between 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock at night. So there is a device known as salivate, which is available, shown in the tube. So it has several parts. There is a cotton pledget in the inside the tube. So the patient is asked to brush their teeth and finish their meal at least about 2 hours prior to the test. And after that, they are asked to chew on this pledget, and that accumulates saliva into the cotton wool, and then they are asked to spit into the tube. So this has an inner tube and an outer tube. The saliva, the cotton pledget is in the inner tube, and once we receive the sample, we centrifuge it and we collect the saliva from the outer tube. So saliva is a filtrate of plasma. So in that way, it is actually a good test to measure the free cortisol in the plasma. Various cutoffs are used, ranging between 0.13 to 0.55 micrograms per deciliter. The sensitivity of this test is 92 to 100% depending on the cutoff, and specificity again is 93 to 100%. So the advantage of this test is it is non-invasive. It is not dependent on cortisol binding globulin, doesn't depend on drugs that interfere with dexamethasone metabolism, can be done at home. You don't have to admit the patient. And it's also useful in patients who have cyclical Cushing's, where they can collect the sample when they have the symptoms of Cushing's syndrome. But the disadvantage is that there is an enzyme known as 11-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase 2, which is secreted by the salivary glands, which converts cortisol to cortisone, which is the inactive form. And so that may give a falsely low cortisol, salivary cortisol value, especially if the storage has not been appropriate or if there is more degradation that has happened. So hence, nowadays, we also measure salivary cortisone and calculate the cortisol to cortisone ratio, which is helpful in deciding whether the patient has Cushing's or not. And also, there is again more than 50% variability day to day in salivary cortisol, and hence you need at least 2 samples, and the values are altered in shift workers, depression, critically ill, and those who recently crossed time zones. So that also has to be kept in mind. Another point to note with salivary cortisol is the cutoffs which we have used to make a diagnosis or refute a diagnosis of Cushing's are at the lower limit of detection of the currently employed assays for cortisol. So 0.1 is the lower limit of detection, while 0.13 is the diagnostic cutoff. So it's just at the lower limit of detection. Hence, at present, we are working with different immunoassays as well as with LCMS to standardize the salivary cortisol measurement in our lab so that we'll be able to use this as a test for outpatient diagnosis of Cushing syndrome. Next, coming to the dexamethasone suppression test, here you give 1 milligram of dexamethasone orally at 11 p.m. in the night and measure serum cortisol on the next day morning. The normal response should be the dexamethasone should suppress the endogenous cortisol production, and so the morning plasma cortisol should be less than 1.8 microgram per deciliter. This has a good sensitivity and specificity. Specificity is close to 80%. But the disadvantage is that patients who are on OCPs, they can have falsely high serum cortisol levels. Those who are critically ill, nephrotic syndrome, patients with decompensated cirrhosis, who have low cortisol binding globulin, they can have falsely negative results. Also, drugs which accelerate or impair the dexamethasone metabolism can give rise to falsely high or low values. All the anti-epileptic drugs accelerate the dexamethasone metabolism, and hence it is preferable to avoid a dexamethasone suppression test in patients on anti-epileptic drugs. So after we have done the screening tests which I listed, so if 2 out of 3 screening tests are positive, then you know that we are dealing with endogenous cortisol excess, and then we can go to the test for differential diagnosis. Sometimes the tests may be borderline, the results which you get may be borderline, in which case, or the test may be discrepant. One test may show a higher urinary free cortisol, but the dexamethasone suppression test is suppressed. So, or the dexa suppression test is not suppressed, but the midnight cortisol is elevated. So in such situations where there is discrepancy between the different tests, then you can go for a confirmatory test, which is the low-dose dexamethasone suppression test. So dexamethasone is given at 0.5 milligram every 6 hourly. So you start at 12 noon, 6 p.m., 12 midnight, 6 a.m. for 2 days, that is 48 hours. And then serum cortisol is measured at 8 a.m. on the third day. And the cutoff value which is used is 1.8 micrograms per deciliter. If the morning cortisol is more than 1.8, it has a sensitivity of more than 98% and a specificity of 97 to 100% for the diagnosis of Cushing syndrome. In certain special situations, you may have to use particular tests or not use particular tests, especially in pregnancy where the cortisol binding globulin is increased. So you use urinary free cortisol or late night salivary cortisol, dexamethasone suppression tests are falsely negative. In patients on anti-epileptic drugs, dexamethasone metabolism is increased, so dexa suppression tests are unreliable. So you have to use urinary free cortisol, midnight cortisol or late night salivary cortisol. In renal failure, because of the decrease in the urinary excretion of cortisol, the urine-free cortisol will be falsely low, so you use a dexa suppression test. In adrenal incidentalomas, it has been found from various studies that the dexamethasone suppression test performs better than the other tests. In cyclical Cushing's, where you need multiple cortisol measurements over days or weeks, you can use either 24-hour urinary cortisol or you can use late-night salivary cortisol. So when you have a patient with suspected Cushing syndrome, first of all, exclude exogenous glucocorticoid exposure by measuring a morning 8 a.m. cortisol. If morning cortisol is normal or elevated, then proceed with 24-hour urinary cortisol, at least 2 samples, dexamethasone suppression test, and late-night salivary or serum cortisol. And if you have a doubt, then you do a low-dose dexa suppression test. If 2 of these tests are abnormal and if the results are concordant, then you then Cushing syndrome is likely and you proceed with the differential diagnostic test. Whereas if the tests are discordant, then you do a third test or you repeat a test or you do a low-dose dexamethasone suppression test and decide whether or not you're going to proceed in the direction of further testing. If, on the other hand, the clinical suspicion is low and the results are discordant, you don't test at that time. You wait for 2 to 3 weeks, see if any other acute illness has caused a mild increase in cortisol. So let the illness resolve and then test later. So when you have to test, look at the differential diagnosis. So as I said earlier, it is either ACTH dependent or ACTH independent. So to make a diagnosis of ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome, so it should be an elevated ACTH in the presence of elevated cortisol. So you do the plasma ACTH either at 8 a.m. in the morning or at midnight when it is supposed to be the lowest. A caution about ACTH is it is a very heat labile peptide. So it has to be collected in pre-chilled EDTA tubes. That is, the tube has to be placed in ice beforehand and it has to be transported on ice because it rapidly gets degraded at room temperature. So in presence of elevated cortisol, if the ACTH is suppressed, that is less than 5 picograms per ml, it is ACTH independent cortisolexis, that is, it is adrenal Cushing syndrome. If, on the other hand, in presence of elevated cortisol, the ACTH is more than 15 picograms per ml, it is ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome. And in patients with ectopic ACTH producing tumors, where a lot of POMC peptides and ACTH are produced from the tumor without any regulation, there the ACTH levels will be very high, say at least more than 150 picograms per ml in ectopic ACTH dependent Cushing's. When the values are borderline between 5 to 15, it is always best to redo the test. If it is in the midnight, then you redo the test in the morning and you take the proper precautions of collecting the sample and transport it at the appropriate temperature to the lab. Instruct the lab to do a cold centrifuge of the sample to separate the plasma and then do the assay. A study from Mumbai has shown that a midnight ACTH value more than 7.5 picograms per ml has a very good sensitivity in picking up ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome. So when we look at further tests, what we need to understand at this point in time is that in Cushing's disease, that is where there is a pituitary tumor which is producing excess of ACTH and causing Cushing syndrome, the entire HPA axis is functioning at a higher set point. So in this condition, though the cortisol is high, it is the entire axis is still amenable to suppression at a higher set point. So that is the rationale for using a 8 mg or high dose dexamethasone suppression test when you are thinking of pituitary ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome. So in how do you do this test? You can either do this by giving 8 milligrams of dexamethasone at night 11 o'clock and do the serum cortisol on the next day morning at 8 o'clock. Or you can give 2 mg of dexamethasone every 6 hourly. So a total dose of 8 milligram per day for 2 days. And then you do the test on the third day morning at 8 o'clock. So how do we interpret this test? If we are doing an overnight test, a 50 to 80% suppression of the serum cortisol from the baseline. Say, suppose you had a basal cortisol of 40 micrograms per deciliter. So if it is suppressed to less than 8, that is more than 80% suppression, then it has about 56 to 92% sensitivity and specificity for diagnosis of pituitary ACTH dependent Cushing's disease. If you are using the 2 days dexamethasone suppression test, you can also look at more than 90% suppression. Similarly, you can also look at more than 90% suppression with just the overnight test, and that has very good specificity for pituitary ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome. Suppose the basal cortisol was 40, as I stated earlier, you give 8 milligrams of dexamethasone, and after that, the serum cortisol is, say, 3 micrograms per deciliter. So then it is more than 90% suppressed. So that has a very good specificity to pick up pituitary ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome. When it does not suppress to even 50%, then it is more likely to be ectopic ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome, which where the axis is not amenable to suppression. But there are certain pitfalls of this test as well. It can be false positive in small carcinoid tumors, especially bronchial carcinoids and early thymic carcinoids. They can have suppression of the serum cortisol to more than 50% with high-dose dexamethasone. Similarly, patients who have big ACTH-producing tumor macroadenomas, they can remain unsuppressed. So they can be false negative. And hence, this test should not be interpreted in isolation. You should never directly do a high-dose dexamethasone suppression test before doing the other tests which we discussed earlier. Now coming to imaging. Imaging will depend on whether it is ACTH-dependent cause or ACTH-independent. Among the ACTH-dependent, pituitary cause is the most common, 68%. So pituitary MRI with gadolinium contrast and dynamic imaging, where you obtain multiple images of 3 millimeter cuts of the pituitary as the contrast is getting into the normal pituitary initially and later on into the tumor. It helps differentiate the normal pituitary from the tumor very well. And also spoiled gradient imaging helps in better delineation of the tumor against the normal pituitary. So after following this protocol over the last, say, 8 to 10 years, our pickup of pituitary adenomas causing Cushing's has significantly improved, and we don't need much more tests after we have done a pituitary MRI with contrast and dynamic imaging with the spoiled gradient imaging. If you are suspecting ectopic ACTH-producing tumors, as I said, the tumors are most often in the thorax or the abdomen. Very rarely, medullary carcinomas of the thyroid can also cause ectopic ACTH syndrome. So it's important to screen for that. If the source of ectopic ACTH tumor is not obvious, a PET scan, usually a somatostatin receptor oriented scan, that is the DOTATATE PET scan, helps. If you are thinking of a malignant tumor like a lung carcinoma, then you do an FDG PET scan to localize the tumor. So in a pituitary MRI, if you find a lesion more than 6 millimeters, it is indicative of an ACTH-producing tumor. But it's important to remember that 10% of the general population can have pituitary incidentalomas, and majority of them are less than 5 millimeters in size. And hence, when you have a small tumor, you may need to do other imaging modalities to decipher whether it is a ACTH-producing pituitary tumor. If in confusion, you can also do bilateral inferior petrosal sinus sampling and take ACTH samples from the inferior petrosal sinuses to confirm a central source of ACTH excess coming from the pituitary tumor. So I'll just show you some pictures of pituitary and other causes of Cushing's. So this is a patient, a middle-aged lady who came to us with Cushing's disease. High-dose dexamethasone suppression test was suppressed. You are seeing a well-delineated, rounded 6.5 millimeter pituitary microadenoma at the center of the pituitary. On dynamic imaging, this is the later phase of dynamic imaging where you are seeing the contrast has washed out of the rest of the pituitary, but the central part, that is the tumor, has taken up the contrast in the later part of the dynamic imaging. This is a pituitary macroadenoma with Cushing's disease. These patients may not suppress with high-dose dexamethasone suppression test, a point to keep in mind. This is a patient who had presented to us with a very short duration of Cushingoid features. He was in the first year of medical school. He had profound proximal myopathy, severe hypokalemia, and we found that he had a thymic tumor causing ectopic ACTH syndrome. So in such patients, in patients with long-standing pituitary tumors, you may find adrenal enlargement. Sometimes there may be nodular adrenal enlargement also because of prolonged exposure to excess ACTH. Metastatic tumors, especially the ectopic ACTH tumors, can be picked up with DOTATATE PET scan. This is a patient who had a thymic carcinoma, which was operated. He had ectopic ACTH syndrome, and after 2 years, he was found to have recurrence of symptoms of Cushing's, and then we found he had pericardial metastasis. This is a patient with bronchial carcinoid. You're seeing a well-delineated nodule in the left lung. This is a bronchial carcinoid causing ectopic ACTH-dependent Cushing's. This is a patient with an adrenal adenoma on the right side causing ACTH-independent Cushing's syndrome. Sometimes in patients with Cushing's, you may find the ACTH to be low and you find bilateral nodular adrenal enlargement more than 5 millimeter, each nodule more than 5 millimeter like this. This is a condition known as ACTH-independent macronodular adrenal hyperplasia. It could be a genetic condition or it could be due to aberrant receptor expression as I described earlier. The same patient on MRI in phase and out phase, you're seeing bilateral nodular adrenal enlargement. This was a 13-year-old boy who came with florid features of Cushing's, and you can see a big mass here. The entire adrenal, this is an adrenocortical carcinoma. This is an adrenal mass. The entire thing is the adrenal mass with areas of necrosis and highly vascular. This was an adrenocortical carcinoma. Now coming to pseudo-Cushing's. So as I said earlier, these are conditions where the cortisol is mildly elevated due to an underlying cause. And once the cause is corrected, the cortisol excess disappears. So how do we diagnose these conditions? So the ideal test is a dexamethasone CRH test. Because of non-availability of CRH in our country, we quite often don't do this test. We often end up doing the low-dose dexamethasone suppression test, that is 0.5 milligrams 6 hourly for 2 days, and then we do the cortisol on the third day. A word about cyclical Cushing syndrome. So this is a condition where there is intermittent hypercortisolism interspersed with normal or low cortisol levels. So when do you suspect cyclical Cushing's? So you have a patient with florid features of Cushing syndrome, but your lab tests come normal. So that is the situation where you suspect cyclical Cushing's. So the intercyclic phases, that is between two peaks of cortisol, the gap may be between few days to months or years. So the cause could be a pituitary adenoma or ectopic ACTH secreting tumor most often. And this is diagnosed by demonstration of three peaks and two troughs of cortisol levels, either of urinary cortisol or of salivary cortisol. So when you have a patient with suspected Cushing syndrome, so first you will do the screening. First you'll do an 8-AM cortisol to exclude exogenous steroid abuse. After that, you will do the screening test. As I said earlier, the midnight serum or salivary cortisol, 24-hour urine cortisol, low-dose dexamethasone suppression test. If two of these tests are abnormal, then you proceed with an ACTH measurement. If ACTH is suppressed, you think of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome. And if ACTH is normal or high, you think of ACTH-dependent Cushing's. First, evaluate for pituitary. If that is negative, then evaluate for an ectopic source, either with a CT of the thorax and abdomen or with a DOTATATE PET scan. And if by all these modalities you are not able to localize a tumor, sometimes an inferior petrosal sinus sampling will be helpful to differentiate a small tumor in the pituitary which is not picked up on MRI producing excess ACTH. You can make out whether it's a pituitary source or an ectopic source by doing an IPSS. Now coming to treatment, depending on the cause, the treatment has to be decided. Surgical treatment is the first option. For pituitary tumors, endoscopic transnasal transsphenoidal pituitary surgery is the preferred approach. For ectopic tumors, again, surgery first. For adrenal adenoma, unilateral adrenalectomy. And in very sick patients where you are unable to do a definitive surgery in the chest or in the pituitary, then you consider doing a bilateral adrenalectomy. Bilateral adrenalectomy can also be considered when the other modalities of treatment are done and they fail. The patient has persistent Cushing's even after undergoing pituitary surgery or resection of the ectopic ACTH tumor, and the patient is becoming sick, you are unable to control the hypercortisolemia with medications, then you consider bilateral adrenalectomy. So transsphenoidal pituitary surgery is quite often done in our hospital, and we have the expertise for that. After that, we don't give them perioperative steroid cover because these patients already have cortisol excess, and we measure their serum cortisol postoperatively after 8 hours, and then again at 8 a.m. on the postoperative days 1, 2, and 3. And if the morning serum cortisol or any time when the patient has hypocortisolemic symptoms, if the cortisol is less than 2 micrograms per deciliter, it is defined as the patient has gone into remission after the pituitary surgery. If it is between 2 to 5 micrograms per deciliter, if the patient has no symptoms, we will wait for about 6 to 12 hours and repeat the sample. And if it is still between 2 to 5, then we call it as partial remission, and we supplement them with glucocorticoids. The reason for this is when you have a patient with a pituitary adenoma, the adenoma is autonomously producing excess ACTH, that is stimulating cortisol production by the adrenals. Once the adenoma is taken off, the corticotrophs in the remaining normal pituitary have still not recovered from suppression. It takes much more time for the normal corticotrophs to recover from the suppression because they were always subject to suppression by the excess cortisol. So that is why the cortisol comes low after a person is cured by pituitary surgery. So in our hospital, the remission rates are about 80% for all pituitary Cushing's. For microadenomas, the remission rate is about 87%, and macroadenomas, it is 55%. And another postoperative cortisol less than 2 micrograms per deciliter in the first week after surgery is highly predictive of remission. So when a person doesn't achieve remission after surgery, then we have to think of adjuvant therapies. Sometimes a person who goes into remission initially after the pituitary surgery may later develop hypercortisolism because of recurrence of a tumor in the remaining normal pituitary. And this occurs in about 20 to 30% of patients by 5 years after surgery. And hence, it is important to keep all these patients on follow-up and follow-up at least every 6 to 12 months. So when do you suspect recurrence? When there is new onset symptoms of Cushing's, or there is worsening of pre-existing symptoms or comorbidities, like a person was well-controlled glycemia, starts having very high sugars, hypertension, which is difficult to control, or develops weight gain, bruising, osteoporosis, then you suspect recurrence of Cushing's. So various studies in the recent times have shown that a salivary cortisol is the first one that becomes elevated when you are testing for recurrence, and hence that is what is recommended as the first test. But in our place, we have not yet standardized the salivary cortisol testing, and hence we depend on urinary cortisol and overnight dexamethasone cortisol testing. So what are the treatment options for recurrent Cushing's disease? If it is a recurrent pituitary tumor, you can do repeat surgery. The success rates with the second surgery are about 50%. You can consider radiation therapy if the tumor is adjacent to the cavernous sinus and cannot be fully excised. If none of these are possible, you can consider medical therapy or bilateral adrenalectomy. There is one problem with bilateral adrenalectomy. If you have a patient whose tumor grows later on, then they can develop a condition known as Nelson syndrome. You can see this lady fully darkly pigmented. That is because of very high ACTH levels from an enlarging pituitary adenoma causing skin hyperpigmentation. They will not have Cushingoid features because the adrenals have been removed. So there is no cortisol excess, but it's only autonomous excessive ACTH that causes very dark hyperpigmentation. So the treatment for that is removal of the excision of the recurrent adenoma that has developed. Now coming to ectopic ACTH syndrome, in our series, we had a high number of thymic and bronchial carcinoids causing ectopic ACTH syndrome. We also had a few cases of lung malignancies, medullary carcinoma thyroid, as well as neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas. these patients have very high ACTH levels and resulting in very high cortisol levels as well. If surgically resectable, surgery is the first option. If not fully resectable, then a debulking surgery to remove as much of the tumor as possible to reduce the ACTH levels, followed by adjunctive therapy in the form of radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or peptide receptor targeted therapy with lutetium dotatate can be considered. Coming to adrenal Cushing's, if it's an adrenal adenoma, resection will cure the adrenal Cushing's. If it is a carcinoma, then a debulking surgery followed by adjunctive therapy in the form of chemotherapy, radiotherapy, or mitotane, which is an adrenolytic drug, can be considered. If it is macronodular adrenal hyperplasia, like in the case which I showed, then bilateral adrenalectomy is indicated. Coming to medical therapy, it is indicated either as primary therapy when the surgery is going to be delayed. The waiting time for a Cushing's in our hospital is anywhere between 2 weeks to 2 months for pituitary surgery. And so in the meantime, in order to improve their muscle strength by reducing the cortisol levels and to improve their respiratory drive, we give them medical therapy. And also in post-operative persistent or recurrent Cushing's disease, again, you have to use medical therapy until you decide on the appropriate modality of definitive treatment. And in ACTH-dependent Cushing's where you have not localized the tumor, then also you would need medical therapy. So what are the medical therapies? Medical therapies can be directed against the pituitary. To reduce the pituitary ACTH secretion, it could be directed against the adrenals to reduce the adrenal cortisol secretion. It could also be directed towards the glucocorticoid receptor to reduce the action of the glucocorticoid on the glucocorticoid receptor. So coming to pituitary directed therapies, we have cabergoline, which is a dopamine agonist, which has been shown to be effective in the treatment of pituitary adenomas. But the problem is about 1/3 of these patients have treatment escape. That is, they initially respond, but afterwards their treatment effect is lost. So when you compare different series which have used cabergoline for the treatment of ACTH secreting pituitary adenomas, either as primary therapy or as adjunctive therapy following failed surgery, the remission rates are anywhere between 23% to 40%. The other drugs available are pasireotide. You cannot use octreotide in patients with Cushing's because the cortisol itself causes downregulation of SST2 receptors on which octreotide acts. Hence, octreotide cannot be used in Cushing's disease. You have to use another drug of the similar class called pasireotide, which acts more on SST3 and SST5 somatostatin receptors. It has been shown to normalize the urinary cortisol in 26% and reduce the urinary cortisol levels in 50% of treated subjects. But pasireotide is known for its major side effect of causing severe hyperglycemia and complications of due to hyperglycemia. Hence, it is not a very preferred drug. It is also very expensive. Only when you have no other option, then you would consider using this drug. The most easily available is ketoconazole, which inhibits adrenal cortisol production. It acts by inhibiting various enzymes in the cortisol synthetic pathway. Various studies have shown remission rates of cortisol excess ranging from 50 to 90%. But the main side effect to remember is that it can cause increase in liver enzymes, which are observed between about 13% of patients. Most often the liver enzyme elevation is mild, less than threefold, and you just have to make adjustments in the drug dosage, and quite often well tolerated. But again, escape is another problem. That is, a patient who initially responded may stop responding to the drug, and this is seen in about 10 to 20% of the patients. Hence, it's not a long-term solution as well. People have also considered combination therapies, combining cabergoline with ketoconazole or combining all the three drugs. And the efficacy is better when you combine two or more drugs. And those with higher baseline cortisol levels responded better to different modalities of blocking the cortisol production. So I'll just conclude with a case which we have currently in the ward. This man is a 43-year-old gentleman who was seen earlier outside until May 2020. In October 2016, he presented with Cushingoid features with swelling of the legs, abdominal distension, newly diagnosed diabetes and hypertension at the age of 39 years. So this qualifies for evaluation for Cushing syndrome. So he was evaluated outside, diagnosed to have A-stage dependent Cushing's. His MRI brain was normal. CT thorax picked up a 2 into 3 centimeter anterior mediastinal mass, which was suspected to be a thymic carcinoid tumor. He also had bilateral adrenal enlargement on the CT scan. He underwent surgery for the thymic tumor. It was a typical thymic neuroendocrine tumor with a low MIB1 index. So they were satisfied that the tumor has been excised. He was well for a while, a year or so, and subsequently he again developed symptoms of Cushing's. At that time, a DOTA-8 PET scan was performed and that showed uptake in mediastinal nodes. So they were resected. Subsequently, he became well. Then again, in 4 months' time, he had recurrence of symptoms. Then again, he had uptake in the supraclavicular node, which was excised. Again, for a year, he was fine. Then again, relapse of Cushing's. Again, now he had developed metastasis in the pericardiac region. So this was not resectable. So they decided on doing lutetium dotatate therapy. He took only one dose of therapy. His Cushing's was worsening. He was becoming sicker. So he was advised bilateral adrenalectomy. But subsequently, he got scared and was lost to follow up. Then he came to us in May 2020 with prolonged fever and cough. He was admitted under medicine and was diagnosed to have disseminated tuberculosis. He had pancytopenia, so he had involvement of bone marrow as well as the lungs with cavitary lesions. He was started on weight-based antitubercular treatment, and for treatment of hypercortisolemia, which had recurred by then, he was started on ketoconazole because he could not be offered any form of surgical treatment in view of a widely metastatic disease. So he has been going on like that, and for the last 7 months, his cortisol has not budged. On the other hand, his urinary cortisols are progressively increasing over time. Now he has completed 6 months of antitubercular treatment, and so we thought this is the right time for him to undergo bilateral adrenalectomy. But he also has the diffusely metastatic neuroendocrine carcinoma that has to be treated with multiple doses of lutetium dotatate therapy. So the treatment of Cushing's in some cases is not straightforward, as you saw in this case, so many recurrences and posing different challenges at different points in time. So to summarize, the diagnosis of Cushing's syndrome may be difficult in certain situations, and one needs to have a high index of suspicion. An algorithmic approach, starting with a basal ATM cortisol, followed by screening tests, followed by tests for differential diagnosis, would be the way to go about. Straight going into high-dose dexamethasone suppression test and such kind of crossing the protocols would only lead us into more trouble. Imaging modality would have to be decided based on the A-stage-dependent versus A-stage-independent Cushing syndrome. Treatment options for all these would be surgery whenever feasible, followed by adjunctive therapy if they are not cured. Thank you, and we can take up questions.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a really very detailed and simplified session on the approach to Cushing syndrome. Any questions, if you can voice out or maybe type in the chat box. With respect to when your patient's having a Cushing's disease per se, and then you talked about doing a pituitary adenoma surgery, resection surgery, but also the adrenalectomy part. Does it have to be always, or it's like when you have a hyperplasia per se? Does it revert to okay. normal size without a surgery?
Yeah.
It's a reactive thing, but at the same time,
that's true. So when you have a patient with a pituitary adenoma whose adrenals are enlarged because of the constant exposure to high ACTH, most often after the ACTH secreting tumor is removed, the adrenal hyperplasia regresses and comes to normal. So you don't have to do an adrenalectomy for that reason. So it's only surgery for the primary tumor. That is, if it's a pituitary tumor, you operate the pituitary tumor. If it's ectopic ACTH, then you operate that tumor. You don't have to do a bilateral adrenalectomy. Bilateral adrenalectomy is only indicated as a last resort when you have done pituitary or other ectopic tumor surgery, and then you have offered a thought of other modalities of treatment for the primary tumor. Nothing is working, like in this case, which I presented, where multiple surgeries, radiotherapy, and despite that, the patient has a tumor which is causing cortisol excess. Then you would consider bilateral.
Hyperplasia plus per se can reverse.
Yeah, hyperplasia per se will revert back to normal.
And how often do we like monitor if they have a resection in terms of like adenoma, micro or macroadenoma, like once resected?
Once resected, we tell them to check their cortisol, serum cortisol levels 8 AM every 6 months.
6 months.
So most often patients don't come back at 6 months. So first follow-up will be at 3 months. So because what would have happened is if somebody has gone into remission, they would be on steroids.
Mm.
They would be on replacement dose of steroids. So we tell them to come back at 3 months. Then we stop the prednisolone for 48 hours. We check their morning cortisol to check if their HPA axis has recovered. If it has recovered, then we stop the prednisolone and we ask them to do a cortisol at 6 months in their hometown and send us the report. If that cortisol is elevated, then we will tell them to do a dexamethasone suppression test at their hometown. If that is elevated, we call them back immediately. If not, if that cortisol is normal, then we call them at 1 year.
And that, if it's normal, you don't image?
Yeah, no. If it is normal, we don't image. Only if it is abnormal, then we start imaging.
And replacement means you only replace steroids with fluticasone and other kind of modality.
Fluticasone is not required because the adrenals are intact.
Yeah, even
the mineralocorticoid axis, which is regulated by renin-aldo.
Unless it's an adrenalectomy done.
Then we don't replace fluticasone. Fluticasone is only given when there is bilateral
adrenalectomy. There's a question. Just a comment. I think someone has mentioned it's a fantastic presentation, clear to the point and very well done. Please, could these excellent webinars be made available to Global CMC alumni who may not be able to attend live soon session? Please, could the link for the record session be sent to CMC alumni group email? Thank you very much. That might be feasible and it'll be done. I think there's a very detailed session. If any questions, that I'm not sure about the live Zoom session being recorded and being uploaded, given the link to the other via mail. This is anyways always uploaded in the website, YouTube website. The link will be sent to in the chat box now. All the lectures which is recorded will be uploaded, which can be accessed anytime from anywhere. Can have your questions mailed later on also. I think for today we'll wind up. We'll put down the link and then maybe we'll wind up the session. Thank you. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for that, as I mentioned, very detailed and simplified lecture. We'll meet again for endocrine lectures on next Friday, 4:30 p.m. We'll be having a lecture on geriatrics on next Monday, coming Monday at 3 p.m. by Dr. Prasad Matthews on dementia. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.